In the north of Scotland, spring can be full of surprises. As they marched from Nairn to Inverness, the men of the British Army cursed the showers of sleet and snow, which transformed the promising spring day of April the 16th, 1746, back into the depths of midwinter. But the subdued mood of the rank and file was not shared by their leader, William, Duke of Cumberland, the second son of George II. Despite the conditions, he knew his troops were ready for the coming battle with the Highland army of Charles Edward Louis John Sylvester Maria Casimir Stuart, better known as Bonnie Prince Charlie.
Well, of course, during the Rising, Charles had been a sort of romantic leader. He obviously had certain qualities. He must have been quite brave. He put up with great hardship without a complaint, and he must have had a kind of charisma that attracted people.
Charles Edward Stuart and William, Duke of Cumberland, second cousins twice removed, but family ties counted for nothing here. They were about to meet in the infamous Battle of Culloden Moor, the final clash in a civil war which had divided a nation.
Oh, Charles Edward wanted one thing. He wanted to be king of Great Britain, and all else was subordinate, including religion.
The government troops, led by Cumberland, were well supplied with food and ammunition. Their training and discipline was good. They were ready for battle. Their opponents were not. The men of the Prince's Highland Army were exhausted and on the point of starvation. Like the late snow of the spring of 1746, the Prince's army was melting away.
The two armies were in very different shape on the fatal 16th of April. The Royal Army, that's the Duke of Cumberland's army, had been celebrating the Duke's birthday. They were well trained, and they had superior artillery, and above all, they had superior cavalry. The Highland Army was, however, widely dispersed. The commissariat had broken down, and although the army had been up on Culloden Moor waiting for the battle for 24 hours, they'd virtually gone hungry.
As they turned to face the Redcoats, the Highlanders were still suffering from the effects of the desperate night march. To compound matters, the Prince was at loggerhead with his best commander, Lord George Murray, and he was now far from home, friendless and isolated, leading a half-starved, disheartened rabble against a well-prepared professional army. Charles Edward's lack of military experience was a factor in the coming debacle, as the eminent military historian Dr. David Chandler explains from the battlefield.
Although he had a fairly high idea of his abilities, got totally from reading books, I might say, as a soldier. In fact, he'd never been in any active service at all in his life. He'd once attended as a young teenager a siege on the continent as a spectator, but he really believed that streak of stubbornness that he knew it all, and therefore he did not need all that much guidance.
All his life, Charles Edward Stuart had dreamed of military glory. He coveted the opportunity to lead his men in battle and regain the lost throne of Britain. But in his mind's eye, Charles must surely have imagined a more auspicious career as a commander than this sad fare.
At Culloden, though, it all went wrong. Partly because the Highlanders had a long way to go. As you can see there, that red flag more or less marks where this started off from. It's about 500 metres down to where the government force was standing. The regulars didn't panic. The Highlanders came rushing up, expecting the Redcoats to run away, and they didn't. They stood there, they shot them, they shot them, and shot them.
The momentous events of the coming day become ingrained in the folk memory of Scotland, and Bonnie Prince Charlie would forever be associated with the tragedy of Culloden Moor.
By the time that Culloden was fought, the prince was no longer a fit person to lead Jacobite forces. Essentially, he was only able to show his talents when things had gone well, and when things started to go badly, his own self-confidence came apart, and he became, in fact, liable to psychosomatic illnesses, of which there were a number during the retreat.
This is the enduring legacy of Bond Prince Charlie. The silent graves of the clansmen slowly crumbling back to earth on a desolate moor. The bleak reminder of the climax to an ill-supported rebellion. The bloody sideshow which marked the last act in the tragedy of the Royal House of Stuart.
The failure of the Jacobite Rising and the very ruthless suppression of the Highlands which followed have had long-lasting and very serious consequences. They really destroyed a civilization in the Highlands, a whole way of life, was never fully recovered, you know, led to the clearances, the loss of population. The place is still a depopulated area, a devastated area in consequence of that.
This final curtain call was, almost single-handedly, Prince's work. To some, he is a drunkard, a liar and a womanizer. For others, he will always remain the great romantic hero of Scotland.
He did turn out, for example, as a good soldier and a warrior prince, which people approved of in those days, and which he seemed to carry off with great success. But I think if we perhaps delve a bit deeper, we find that we have a selfish and an egotistical personality.
If we are really to understand why British soldiers came to fight a Highland army led by an Italian-born prince, we must go back more than 100 years to the reign of the last Tudor monarch, Elizabeth I. James Stuart, King of Scotland, became the first monarch to sit upon the combined throne of Scotland and England when he succeeded a childless Elizabeth I in 1603. As a Scot, James was canny enough to avoid alienating his new English subjects. But son Charles mismanaged his rule to such an extent that a civil war resulted. Charles was beheaded in 1649. Despite his father's grisly fate, a new Stuart king, Charles II, was restored to the throne in 1660. But he died childless and was succeeded by his brother James. However, within just 3 years, James II had alienated his people as surely as his father had done before him. James II fled to France, and the vacant throne was offered to his Protestant daughter Mary and her husband, William of Orange. However, as history would testify, the Stuarts would not give up the claim to the throne without a fight. James II and his supporters, known as the Jacobites, from the Latin for Jane, tried unsuccessfully to regain his throne with risings in both Ireland and Scotland. Both ended in failure. The years of exile had begun for the Stuarts, who became known to their wistful Jacobite supporters as the Kings Across the Water. There were now two entirely separate claims to the throne of Britain. With the death of James II in 1701, the Stuart claim to the throne passed to his son, also named James, who could have become James III, but was to become better known to posterity as the Old Pretender. James made a number of military attempts to regain his throne, but risings in Scotland, 1708, 1715, and 1719, all ended in failure. From exile in France, James watched as unfavorable events in Britain took the elusive crown further from his grasp. The successor to the childless William and Mary, Queen Anne, died in 1714. She too left no heir, and Parliament offered the crown to the nearest Protestant branch of the Stuart family, headed by George, Elector of Hanover, despite the fact that he spoke only German. The Hanoverian grip on throne was tightened when George II succeeded his father in 1727. He, at least, spoke English. In opposition to George, the active role in the Jacobite cause was assured by the eldest son of the pretender, Charles Edward Stuart, born into exile in Rome on December the 20th, 1720. The young prince was the eldest son of the pretender, James, and his Polish wife, Klementyna Sobieska. Growing up in the cosmopolitan world of the exiled Stuart court was certainly a colorful existence, and the young prince and his brother Henry benefited from a wealth of varied experiences, which produced a strong, fit young man who loved to ride, hunt, play music, and dance, all of which he mastered with equal ease. Family life was a less happy experience.
His father was worthy, austere, a bit prematurely aged. His mother was a Polish princess, highly strung, deeply religious, no great effect on his life or his upbringing. And she died in the 1730s.
While his mother was still alive, the young prince always had to tread a careful line between Klementyna and James, as his surviving letters testify.
Dear Papa, I thank you mightily for your kind letter. I shall strive to obey you in all things. I will be very dutiful to Mama, but not jump too near her. I long to see you soon and in good health. I am, dear Papa, your most dutiful and affectionate son, Charles, Prince of Wales.
I think we're bound to find within the period of his childhood and upbringing some explanations as to how he behaved in Scotland and how he behaved after the 1745. It's difficult to pin down exactly how the stormy relationship between his parents and the lack of love between his parents affected him, because in fact, in detail, we don't know as much as we'd like to about the young prince's life in the Stuart court in exile. But I think there are one or two points to emphasize. The first is that given that particular period of the late Middle Ages, the early modern period, the rearing of a prince and a king-to-be was according to a set pattern. And he was brought up in a court, and everyone behaved to him in a particular way, and he received all the instructions proper for a king.
He may well have received an excellent school, but as he grew into manhood, the prince did reveal a couple of worrying traits which were never to leave him. The first was his profligacy. He spent lavishly on himself, always dressing in the finest clothes and loving nothing better than to have his portrait painted. The Stuart household accounts for 1743, for example, show that Charles's personal expenditure was three times as much as his brother and 10 times as much as his father. The other worrying trait was fondness for drink.
If Charles had been born in a different age and from a different social background, there's little doubt that he would have had a prime claim to therapy. Charles was brought up spoilt, the product of a broken marriage, and under intense personal and political pressure to succeed. It's not much wonder that he went for the bottle.
Despite his flaws, Charles grew up to become a fit, handsome, and athletic young man. So he was physically prepared for action and hardship when the distant prospect of regaining the throne of Britain flickered back to life. In 1744, Britain and France became embroiled in yet another war, and despite all their previous experiences, some Scots Jacobites were planning yet another rising. Now nearly 60 years of age, the old pretender wisely passed up the prospect of further forlorn attempt at his elusive prize. However, James considered French military help a distinct possibility, and the 24-year-old Prince Charles, with the rashness of youth, was prepared to stake everything on one last throw of the dice.
I don't think the Jacobite cause are by any means dead in 1745. There were so many elements in it. It was far more than just a romantic attachment to the legitimate royal line, although that was an element in it. It was also regarded, widely regarded in Scotland, as a means of escaping from the Union, which was vastly unpopular. And of course, Charles did issue a proclamation and arrived in Edinburgh saying he would repeal the Union.
Charles left Rome and slipped into France in the hope that his presence would provoke the French king, Louis, into action on behalf of the Stuarts. He was to be disappointed. In the year he spent in France, the prince never once met Louis. The surviving letters from Charles are very revealing. In order to buy time, Charles was clearly prepared to mislead his father if necessary. In 1744, he wrote to James, giving the strong impression that he had actually met the French king.
Dear Papa, I am well, and I trust this finds you also. I have met with all that could be expected of the King of France, who expresses great tenderness, and will be careful of all my concerns.
The French care and tenderness was never to materialize. It seems the French court viewed the Jacobite chance of success in a very dim light. Louis XV of France continually refused to grant Charles an audience. In the end, Charles was reduced to writing Louis, begging for a meeting.
After having tried in vain all methods of reaching your majesty in the hope of obtaining the help necessary to enable me to play a role worthy of my birth, I have resolved to make myself known by my actions and to undertake alone a project to which even a small amount of help would guarantee success.
Suddenly, in 1744, there was a glimmer of hope. The French unexpectedly sanctioned and prepared an invasion in support of the Stuarts. A French fleet sailed, with Charles aboard, but after a fierce storm sucked some of their transport, it returned to France, and the young prince was consigned to a frustrating year ashore. Charles Edward Stuart was clearly not a man to take a hint. Frustrated beyond endurance, he resolved to raise the money himself to finance a small expedition to Scotland and lead another rebellion in his father's name. The rash adventure had begun. It started without the knowledge or permission of his father. Charles Edward wrote to inform James of his journey to Scotland, safe in the knowledge that the letters would reach him only when it was too late for the old man to intervene.
I believe your majesty little expected a courier at this time, and much less from me, to tell you a thing that will be a great surprise to you. I have been invited by our friends to go to Scotland, and to carry what money and arms I could conveniently get, this being the only way of restoring you to the crown and them to their liberties. I have presumed to take upon me the management of all this, without even letting you suspect there was any such thing brewing, for fear that you might have thought what I was going to do to be rash, and so to have absolutely forbidden my proceeding.
Landing with only seven companions at Arisaig on the west coast of Scotland, the prince did not give the appearance of a man about to lead a triumphant crusade. The larger of his two ships had been intercepted and attacked by British warships, but the clan chiefs grudgingly agreed to support a rising in the belief that they would be assisting a coming invasion by French regular troops. Not for the last time, the prince was forced to give out a lie that substantial French military help was not far behind. From his frosty reception in France, he must have known that to be a remote prospect.
I think it's probably too sharp a distinction to say the prince was telling outright lies about French help. The prince was exaggerating prospect of French help, but he felt sure that France's hand would be forced if the Jacobites marched south, and indeed this proved to be the case.
It is a testament to the prince's determination that somehow he had managed to persuade even a few chiefs to join him. Some historians ascribe this change of heart to the prince's personal charisma, others to the Highland sense of duty and loyalty, others still to the strong drink which was taken, toasts which made, and rash promises given.
In the first narrative, Alexander MacDonald, the poet, has a nice quote which gives us a good impression of the effect that the prince had on people. Perhaps he was charismatic. There entered the tent a tall youth of a most agreeable aspect in a plain black coat with a plain shirt, not very clean, and a cambric stock fixed with a plain silver buckle. At his first appearance, I found my heart swell to my very throat.
In view of the meager support he had received, a shrewder man might have abandoned the scheme at that point. But unwanted, with the optimism of youth, the young pretender soldiered on. Here, at Glenfinnan, on the 19th of August, 1745, the prince's standard was raised, more in hope than expectation. At first, it seemed none would come. Then, in a fairy tale moment, like an episode from a romantic novel, the sound of pipes were heard echoing down the empty glen. Much against their better judgment, here were Cameron of Lochiel, the MacDonalds of Glengarry, the men of Keephock, and the young Clanranald and his followers. The rising had begun. Once raised, the prince's small army marched on Edinburgh. As they marched southward, additional numbers came in, swelling the ranks to 1,200 men. And suddenly there was hope, where there had only been uncertainty.
The basic problem for the whole of the Bonnie Prince Charles cause in 45 was a lack of popular support he received in Scotland, above all. It's not always realised only six clans actually rallied to him. The rest either stayed passive or rallied to the government. The other side of the coin is, of course, that the King George II was very popular at this period. He'd been the last King of England ever to serve on the battlefield at the Battle of Ettingen in 1743. He spoke English, which his father, George I, had never done, and there's no doubt he was a popular monarch.
The commander of the British troops in Scotland, General Sir John Cope, found to his dismay that the pro-government clans were not particularly willing to fight. So Cope decided to turn aside rather than risk a battle. He therefore made for Aberdeen. With Cope out of the way, the road to the south now lay open, and the prince raced southwards for Edinburgh, which was captured by surprise on the 17th of September. Forced into action, General Cope found enough shipping to take his army south by sea to confront the prince. He expected an easy victory, but his troops were surprised and routed by the Highland army in less than 10 minutes at the Battle of Preston Pans, early on the morning of the 21st of September, 1745. The nervous government cavalry fled the field. The battle quickly degenerated into a bloody rout. Against all expectations, the prince had won his first victory. But the architect of the victory was the Jacobite general, Lord George Murray. Soon the prince was to be at loggerheads with his best commander.
It's been suggested that Charles's bad relationship with the older generation of Jacobites, notably people like the Earl Marshal and Lord George Murray, was because, this is of course highly speculative, because he regarded them as far figures, as natural friends and allies of his father. They, after all, deported his father in the rising of 1715, and therefore he was very unwilling to bow to their authority.
With Scotland secure, Charles had his father proclaimed James VIII of Scotland and attended a great ball in Edinburgh. But at this moment triumph, the first signs of dissent began to appear. The Jacobites had won Scotland for the Stuarts, and many felt they had discharged their obligation to the prince. Others were still dispirited that the prince chose not to repeal the Act of Union of 1708.
When Charles arrived in Edinburgh, he issued a proclamation saying that he would repeal the Act of Union because he knew that the Act of Union was very unpopular in Scotland, and this therefore was simply an appeal to popular support. He did have a great deal of popular support in Scotland for that reason.
Charles Edward Stuart clearly had his sights firmly set on the English throne. But the invasion of England would require a large professional force, and the prince was still unsupported by the promised French landings. He overestimated his Highland army, but it was now the only option for invading England. As the prince would spare no men to garrison the city, on the 1st of November 1745, Edinburgh was abandoned and the invasion of England begun. The army marched on London against the expressed wishes of almost all the Highland chiefs. The invasion progressed rapidly. By avoiding Hawley's strong government army at Newcastle, the Jacobites were soon in control of Manchester. Despite the fact that church bells rang and crowds came to cheer, the prince was devastated to find that there were pitifully few volunteers prepared to actually join the rebellion. Less than 300 of his prospective English subjects actually joined the prince's army. The Duke of Cumberland, with the second government army, more than twice the size of Charles's, tried to intercept the Jacobites in Lichfield, but they bypassed him too, and by the 4th of December were at Derby, only 120 miles from London. Panic swept the capital, and there was a run on the Bank of England. The mood of desperation and spreading terror was captured by Hogarth in this famous scene, the March of the Guards from Finchley. Meanwhile, the Jacobite army remained halted at Derby. There, the young pretender and his officers argued for 2 days about what to do next. Charles was pushing on to London, but the others disagreed. The French had not landed, and that crucially there was no sign of real support from the English population. In the end, Charles had to accept their decision. He evermore considered himself betrayed by the Highland chiefs. Their differences would ultimately escalate into all-out war.
The main reason why the Council of War decided to turn back was the absence of English support and the belief that the reiterated promises of Charles about French and English support were in fact wildly over-optimistic, not to say downright misleading.
With the fateful decision to turn north, the Jacobite cause had reached its high watermark. On the 6th of December, the small army turned around and began retreating northwards. The conquering heroes were now treated with scorn and derision by the same crowds who had cheered them so heartily. The Jacobites retreated northwards and made an aimless attempt to lay siege to Stirling Castle. General Henry Hawley attempted to relieve the garrison. The Jacobites defeated him in a hard-fought battle outside Falkirk on the 17th of January, 1746. For the Duke of Cumberland, this was the last straw. He now set out to destroy the prince's cause once and for all. His army was powerful and well-equipped. Crucially, he could also call on three times as many troops as Charles. The military situation was certainly deteriorating for Charles, who had by now come to a complete breach with Murray. The battle of wills between two stubborn men has left us this acrimonious letter from the Prince to Lord George regarding control of the Jacobite army, which had effectively been usurped by a military council composed of the chiefs and led by Lord George.
When I came into Scotland, I knew well enough what I was to expect from my enemies, but I little foresaw what I meet with from my friends. I came vested with all the authority the king could give me, one chief part of which is the command of his armies, and now I am required to give this up to 15 or 16 persons. But it can be no army at all, where there is no general, or which is the same thing, no obedience or deference paid to him. I shall only tell you that my authority may be taken from me by violence, but I shall never resign it like an idiot.
Despite another of his increasingly frequent temper tantrums, the prince bowed to pressure from Murray and his council of war, and the Jacobites retreated northwards. They travelled through the harsh blizzards of the mountains of Scotland, in the hope that the unforgiving terrain would deter pursuit. Cumberland was not to be deterred. His sudden advance caught the Jacobite army by surprise, and there was no real option left but to fight. So, on the morning of the 14th of April, 1746, they marched out from Inverness, prepared to take up their battle positions on Culloden Moor. But the government army did not appear that day, nor the next. The 15th of April was Cumberland's birthday. As the Jacobites waited in vain for the British army to advance, they hatched a desperate plan. Murray suspected that as Cumberland's men were celebrating the Duke's birthday, they were likely to be, in his words, drunk as beggars. He therefore championed the ill-fated plan to secretly march on Cumberland's army on the night of the 15th, and mount a dawn attack on the sleeping camp. For once, even the petulant Prince Charles was in full agreement. The result was the infamous all-night march which preceded the Battle of Culloden. About 8 p.m. that night, the whole Jacobite army set off. But by first light, they were still 2 miles short of their objective, and it was clear that the British army would be ready and waiting for them in broad daylight. Murray therefore abandoned the attempt and ordered his men back to Culloden Moor. The prince was furious, but there was nothing to be done. After a night spent blundering around in darkness, all that had been achieved was to exhort his men on the eve of their greatest trial. Worse still, the Jacobites' makeshift supply system couldn't provide food for the returning army. Dispirited, tired and hungry, large numbers wandered off in the vain hope of finding some food, while others simply sought to sleep. For many, it would be their last. The Highlanders did not like the field. The moor to their front was flat and open, less than ideal for the fearsome Highland charge which had brought victory at Preston Pans and Falkirk.
The Highland charge is usually seen as a matter of a load of men in kilts, bounding across the heather, waving swords, axes and all sorts. They rush up to the enemy and literally start carving them to pieces. In actual fact, it didn't really work out that way. What happened was that they'd come screaming down a great big mob and frightened the life out of the opposition, who usually ran away before the Highlanders got near them.
All in all, the prince's army ought to have mustered some 6,500 infantry. Unfortunately, far too many of the Highlanders had straggled off in search of food and shelter, and the Jacobite army at Culloden could field less than 4,000 infantry. On the other side of the moor, Cumberland had some 8,000 men. The British army which was to fight on Culloden Moor is often pictured as being an English army, but a high proportion of them were actually Scots. Military historian Dr. David Chandler takes up the story from Culloden Moor.
Of the 16 regiments which made up the bulk of the government forces under Cumberland, no less than 4 were in fact Scottish. 3 of those were from the Lowlands, but the 4th, Argyll's militia, was in fact a Highland formation. Fire!
As the two armies faced each other, the first shots from the Prince's guns were answered by the rapid fire of the gunners of the Royal Artillery. It was no match. The Highland guns were soon silenced, and the government cannons were able to play at will against the static lines of the Prince's army, causing horrific injuries among the stationary lines of men as they awaited the order to charge. But the order did not come. No one knows for sure how long the order to charge took to travel from the Prince, behind the second line, to the Highland regiments in the front line. Some accounts say his messenger was killed by a cannon shot. Others put the blame squarely on the Prince's indecision.
In military terms, the cannonade was not very effective. The guns were knocking over an average of one man with every shot fired. They had 10 guns, each one firing at once a minute. With a cannonade lasting only about a quarter of an hour, that's not killing very many Jacobites. Where the killing really started, once they got down close to the government line, and the artillerymen switched from firing cannonballs to firing grapeshot, which is effectively a bag full of musket balls, worked like a shotgun. Now that did kill people.
To reach the government forces, the Highlands had to charge across an open expanse of moorland, all the while exposed to the cannons and muskets of well-drilled opponents. Most Highlanders did not even reach the government lines. The full weight of the Highland attack fell upon just two government regiments, Barrel and Monroe's. In the brief struggle which followed, 200 government soldiers were killed or wounded in a vicious hand-to-hand fight. But for the first time, the discipline of the government troop held firm, and despite the ferocity of the Highlanders' attack, the Prince's men were soon halted. Just as quickly, they turned to fight.
As Napoleon would say a generation or more later, better one bad general than two good ones. And this division of command, therefore, within the army of the Bonnie Prince Charlie, was a fatal complication.
In the space of those terrible minutes, 800 clansmen were killed or wounded. Was it about this time that Prince Charles himself made his escape? Lord Elcho, the leader of his own bodyguard, is alleged to have called bitterly after him, "Run, you cowardly Italian!" With Elko's cry ringing in his ears, he rode off the field with a small escort of French cavalry to look to his own destiny.
He assumed that he'd been betrayed, and he assumed he'd been betrayed by Lord George Murray, his own commander. There all had been bad feeling between the two all along, right throughout the rising. It came to a head, and when the battle was seen to be lost, he turned about and he left the field of battle.
The aftermath of the battle was savage and brutal. Determined that there would never be another rising against his father, the king, Cumberland set about the fierce repression which would earn him the name by which he is still known in Scotland today, the Butcher. In the days that followed, a number of atrocities were committed throughout the Highlands by small groups and squads of government soldiers under the direction of their officers. Over the next few days, the number of prisoners rose dramatically as the wounded Jacobites were brought in from Moor and fleeing fugitives were captured. But the Prince was not among them. Although he was aware of the outrages committed against his subjects, Prince Charles Edward Stuart was not of a mind to give himself up simply to spare them further hardship. He still believed himself to have been betrayed by Scots, but he remained in hiding among them, intent only on escaping to France. He used the Highland code of honor to his full advantage, and the wildness also served to swallow up the prince and hide him from his pursuers. The harshness of life on the run did take its toll. Beside his ill health, one worry was his increasing reliance on brandy, which he drank to excess throughout his time on the run. It was clearly becoming a problem the prince could not control. Despite the excesses of the British army, the Scots code of honor held true. None came forward to collect the £30,000 reward offered for betraying the prince. In 1746, this was a fabulous sum of money, the equivalent of £1 million today.
Well, in spite of the large ransom that was offered to betray Charles, he of course was not betrayed in Scotland. The reason for this, I suppose, several reasons. First of all, there was strong residual loyalty to the Royal House of Scotland, of which he was the descendant, because he was popular from that point of view, and also because he offered some hope of escape from the Union.
Finally, Charles was able to escape to France, suffering the ignominy of having to disguise himself as a woman to do so. Flora MacDonald was the woman who helped him. Contrary to popular opinion, no love was lost between them, and she paid the price for helping the prince with a year in jail. In later years, she received not one word of thanks or any recompense from the prince she had helped to escape. Ingratitude may well have been another Stuart trait.
In 8 days, he returned to Borrowdale in Arisaig, where he first landed, and after refreshing himself well, directly went aboard, and with a fair wind set sail next morning for France, and left us all in a worse state than he found us. He seemed to be in good spirit, and addressed himself to such as stayed behind to live in good hopes, and that he expected to see us soon with such a force as would enable him to reimburse us for our losses and trouble, so that he ended as he began. With those very words written just after the 45, it seems to bring us into direct contact with the feelings and emotions of those who took part. There is this note of skepticism and, one might say, weary cynicism.
Safely back in France, Charles assumed the role of society hero. He was cheered and applauded wherever he went. But King Louis, who now sought peace with England, considered the prince to be a political embarrassment. He was incensed to hear of Charles basking in the public adoration, visiting the opera, and preening himself in public, despite Louis's explicit instruction for him to remain incognito.
He wouldn't leave France, and Louis had to have him kidnapped at the opera and forcibly exiled. That was felt bitterly by Charles Edward, by his supporters, and by the French public, for whom Charles Edward was a hero.
Charles was now back in Italy. Like the cause he espoused, the affairs of Prince Charles Edward had reached their high watermark. The rest of his life was a slow decline into obscurity and alcoholism. His relationships with women always brought unhappiness. He had an illegitimate daughter named Charlotte from his relationship with Clementina Walkinshaw.
He was a brute in his relations with women. He was callous to a degree. They had a child who died, but he then, the liaison was discovered and forbidden by her family, and he just comes all off.
An unhappy marriage to Louise de Stolberg produced no children, and public humiliation for Charles when he was first cuckolded, then abandoned by his younger wife. As his brother Henry was now a senior figure in the Roman Catholic Church, the Stuart claim effectively ended with Charles. Even the simple task of providing a legitimate heir was now beyond him. It fell to his illegitimate daughter to comfort and look after the dying Prince Charles as he sank into decrepitude.
He does have a court when his father dies in 1766 in Rome, which of course is fatal to his prospects for ever becoming king of Protestant Britain. He is a pensioner of the Pope now.
There is something terribly poignant about the legendary figure, who will forever be celebrated as a dazzling young man, slipping into old age, senility, and drunkenness. Perhaps it would have been better if he had not sought to save his own skin and been killed at Culloden with his men. Then, at least, he would have been revered forever. The Bonny Prince Charlie of legend. In 1900, the historian Andrew Lang eloquently encapsulated that sentiment. All the world has regretted that the prince did not fall as Keppoch fell, leaving an unblemished fame. They did not ride back, even if it were alone, and die with glory. Thank you.